Hi, and welcome to Animalia the Podcast. I'm Natasha, and thank you so much for tuning in. Remember to check out the website, animaliathepod.com, for archived episodes and much more. Search Animalia the Pod on your favorite podcast platform or SoundCloud or YouTube for new episodes. You should also like and follow the Facebook and Instagram pages. And if you'd like to appear on the podcast, send an email to animaliathepod@gmail.com. This week on Animalia, we talk about what happens when a beloved member of the family crosses the rainbow bridge, as we say. Saying your final goodbye is often a difficult process, and you may consider what's the best way to memorialize the animal's time on Earth in a respectful and meaningful way. Our guest this week will explain one of the modern and environmentally sound ways for pet parents to do just that. She's the mother to 5 rescues and proprietor of Trinidad Pet Crematorium. Please welcome to Animalia, Kristen Agostini. Thank you very much, Kristen, for agreeing to appear on Animalia. First of all, let's start off by talking a little bit about you. Could you tell us about your life growing up with animals? What sort of relationships did you have?
Oh, gosh. Well, I grew up, I actually grew up in the States, which you would figure out pretty quickly once I'm talking. But I had animals of all varieties growing up, from tortoises to rabbits, dogs, of course, birds. So I grew up in a family that just loved animals, treated animals like family, and that's only just developed as I've grown, right? And realized the needs for animal welfare and all of those things. So it's just been an entire life of developing a love for the animal community.
Excellent. So when you came to Trinidad, did that change at all, or did you notice anything different based on where you're from and the context or the reality in Trinidad and Tobago when it comes to animal welfare?
Yes. I mean, I think that there's some pretty severe differences just culturally how we treat animals. But, you know, people have always asked me throughout my time here, like, oh, you know, it must be so difficult to deal with such like stark difference in the animal communities from living in the States to here. And I always approach it from the position of, we have so much room to grow and we have so much room to change how people treat animals and how we value our animals and how we love our animals. And even in the time that I've been here, I've seen such a difference. You see it in the pet shops evolving, the types of foods that are evolving, the expectations from veterinary care is evolving because we're starting to learn more and we're starting to understand that information and education is so vital to making a change, right? And so I don't look at it as negative or positive. I just look at it as different and as an opportunity, right? An opportunity to sort of support and assist a community that really needs it.
Yep, we do. Trust me, we do. I just saw a very harrowing video on Facebook a while ago from Venus Doggess of Love, that NGO based in Tobago. Apparently, someone had poisoned some dogs that live on Rockley Beach Elspeth is trying to, and her friends are trying to save them. You know, it's a very different, I mean, Tobago is even different to Trinidad, right? But as you mentioned, the cultural differences, I agree that there is a lot of opportunity for growth and for change. But I think we don't seem to be, I don't know what it's like in the States, but we don't seem to be as on one accord or on the same page or singing from the same hymn sheet on a lot of issues. Do you agree?
You know, I think so much of it comes with legislation and enforcement, right? You know, I always feel really positive. Like you mentioned Venus, there's so many animal advocates out there on and Mustafa Project and Tompak Rescues and all these pages that it's just surrounded by people who love animals. And I choose to believe that there is a group of people that are uninformed and uneducated and don't understand, you know, how to treat animals. And hopefully what we need is active legislation and enforcement. And that's the difference. I truly think that that's the difference in the States and in Trinidad is there's going to be bad people everywhere. There's going to be people that treat animals badly in every community and in every culture, unfortunately, right? It breaks my heart, but it's just a matter of fact. But we can encourage a shift in legislature, and it comes from the top down, and we're enforcing these laws and these rules, and, you know, we get police stepping in, and it's not just the animal advocates fighting and putting their lives on the line, but actually we're holding people's feet to the fire and saying, we're not allowed to treat people like this, and we're not allowed to treat animals like this, and you don't get to take an animal's life into your own hands.
Correct. But on a lighter note, do you have any pets now that you're in Trinidad, and what are their names?
Their names. Oh gosh, this is the fun part. Okay, so I have five. I have five rescues. I have Birdie Blue Skies Num Num. Okay. Yes, that is her full name. If you ask her dad, I have Jose. They're both small. Those are my first two rescues. And then I have Jackpot, Lord of Faizabad, first of his name. And I have Biscuit. He only has because he's the naughtiest. You don't have time to reprimand him with all those names. You just got to go straight for Biscuit. And then we have Brownie, who's was a failed foster. And she's risen in the ranks. She sleeps right next to me on my pillow. So I always joke that I always have 5.5 dogs because I, you know, work so closely with the rescue community that I always have an ex foster at my house or I'm watching a next dog for a next person. So we always joke that we have 5.5.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So you're a dog lady.
I actually am an all animal lady. My dream is to have goats, mini cats. Yeah. I'd love to have cats. Unfortunately, my husband is tremendously allergic. And I believe he tried to sneak them in the house. So he's very patient with me and my sort of animal obsession.
Right, gotcha. And he's Trini, right?
He is, yeah. He's Trini. So he was born and raised in the community. So even with him, you know, he's had animals his whole life, and I've had to really work with him on, you know, shifting how we treat animals. And of course, he loves them, and he's always been an animal advocate and grew up with animal advocacy. But even nutrition and healthcare and all of those things, you know, when I first told him, you know, our dog had to go in for a dental, I think he fainted. You know, he's like, what? And I'm like, yes, of course.
Yes.
You know, their teeth are just like ours. And I went through it with them. And now, you know, especially our older dogs, they get their dentals annually because, you know, now we as a family understand that the investment into these animals is just like our investment into our family.
Indeed.
Yeah.
So tell me about the Trinidad Pet Crematorium. I just happened upon it on Facebook and I said, well, this is such an interesting service. I mean, I know that there are other places that do it. I have had two of my own cats cremated. Mm-hmm. But what prompted the idea to have a crematorium for pets?
Well, you know, as I mentioned, I've been working alongside the veterinary industry for a long time here in Trinidad, both in rescue and actually in clinic. And some of my, you know, colleagues were telling me, you know, what's happening to a lot of these animals after they are afterlife. And when people are making these really hard decisions for what happens next, there's not a lot of comfort and there are no actual registered pet crematoriums. So outside of just wanting to create a safe, soft space for pet lovers to know that what they're paying for and what's happening with animals is done with integrity and respect and love. It's not just sort of getting sent off somewhere. We thought that was important, but there's also really an environmental impact on a crematorium that is not regulated. Both, you know, its impact on the atmosphere and its impact on what happens when we bury, especially if it's not a responsible burial. So when we realized that that was what was happening, we decided that we were going to put all of the steps in place to develop a crematorium that is eco-friendly, that is good for the environment, and where we know 100% that every single time we are saying goodbye to one of these loving pets, we are treating it with the utmost respect and dignity. So this process started about 5 years ago, And it's taken that long for us to actually go through the entire process and make sure that we are following all of the environmental regulations and that we're doing everything publicly and above board. Not that we're the first that cremates. It's just that we're the first ones who have actually done it following all of the government agencies' guidelines. And we think it's important and it matters, right? Our environmental impact is important just as our treatment of animals is important. It's all of our community and it all makes a difference in how we treat each other, our pets, and how we treat our environment, right? It's all symbiotic.
Yes, indeed. What are the considerations in if you want to burial versus cremation? What are the things that impact environmentally and otherwise on both kinds of disposal?
Right. So as far as cremation is concerned, we have a low emissions crematorium, which means that we are smokeless. There's fun terms in the crematorium industry, like buster. It's a whole thing, but there's smoke busters and this and that. But essentially what it means is that we filter out all of the gases, other aspects of what happens when you have a body. And we filter that out so that our carbon dioxide is super low and our smoke emissions are super low. We actually have Kariri that comes out and does our testing monthly to ensure that our impact on the environment is as low as possible. We're really studying our carbon footprint and trying to make sure that we are being extra responsible with our impact and what we're doing in the community. As far as burial, I know that's really the traditional route that most Trinidadians have gone in the past. The trend has shifted in other countries, mostly because what they've realized is that there are diseases that spread both in your water source and soil. So a common one in Trinidad is lepto, and that can be transferred directly into your water source. So if you look in when you're passing the Betham, a lot of times when you think that you're getting quote unquote burial, your animals are ending up in the Betham, which does not display a lot of love or integrity for the life of the animal. But beyond that, we don't want those diseases going into the water source for the community that lives in Betham. We also don't want those diseases going into the wildlife water source and affecting our wildlife, right? Where we fish, where we swim, and all of those places. So it's about protecting all of us, right? And even with soil burials, you know, if you take the animal into your backyard, which is really common, what we really want to make sure is that your animal did not die of tetanus. Tetanus is transferred through the soil and kills humans and our animals, right? So, and euthanasia drugs can also impact animals. So if an ocelot or an animal that's living out in the wild happened to dig up your animal from your backyard, they can also be impacted. So it's a matter of really assessing what's best for you and your life and what makes you feel better, right? And for me, I think of my animals, and they have such an amazing life. And I know that my animals would want that for other wildlife as well.
Yes, yes. I mean, I never thought of all of those implications. And it's good that you've thought of these things. And it sounds like a really very carefully thought out and planned intervention, I want to say, into the lives of pet owners and their children, as most of us consider them to be. Yeah?
Of course. And, you know, we have so many people that live in so many different ways in this country. And it's important to protect everybody, not just the people that can afford healthcare or to be protected. So if that means, you know, expanding our options and providing alternatives, then we should all be doing that. And that's really the goal. You know, one of my colleagues has a degree in public health and spent a lot of time working in the public health sector in Trinidad. So she really saw the damage and the potential. I mean, we're in a global pandemic now based on an animal transmitting a disease to a human. So we have to be extra cautious and really make sure that we're all educated when we're making these decisions, both from an emotional perspective and a scientific perspective.
Yes, very well said. How do you get your clients? I mean, I know that I was referred to a cremator at my vet, but is that the way that you get most of your clients?
Yeah, that's correct. So we work directly with the veterinary community. The goal is not to eliminate that middleman. The vets are really our allies, and those are the leaders in the animal welfare community. A lot of these vets have seen your pets from puppy, from first vaccination until their last breath. And we respect that relationship so much. So the idea is that, yes, we work directly with your vet. I know most of the vets in the community and have a relationship with them. And so they are aware. When people have reached out to me on Facebook, I then direct them back to their veterinarian. And I will, of course, connect with their veterinarian and let them know that that person had reached out. So yes, the idea is that we go directly through your vet and we continue helping build that bridge and that relationship with vet to client.
Yeah, that relationship is very important. And it's one that we have discussed at length with many vets on this podcast.
Yes.
And in fact, the last cat that I cremated, Pear, he was poisoned.
Oh,
and
gosh.
When I asked the vet to do a necropsy, she actually asked me if what exactly I wanted to do, because she didn't want to to treat his body with the kind of respect and integrity that I would have wanted. And I mean, it may not have been the best time for me to have that conversation, but I said, you know, just do whatever you have to do. I would like to know if you can find the reason for his death, and I then do what you have to do. But I guess that is the most appropriate person to have the conversation with. But in the event that the client wants something else, do you ever come into that conversation and have a conversation with the client and the vet perhaps about what wants to be done?
Of course. Yes. So I'm here in support of whatever is needed. I do know that sometimes that grief is hard. And we're not all great at dealing with it. I lost my mom 4 years ago. It actually has helped me to be able to have conversations with people that are making really complicated decisions and really challenging, in a really challenging time where you're sort of making a permanent decision for someone you love. So I've stepped into that conversation after I've already discussed it with the vet. I always want to make sure that the vet has all of the information first. It's complicated a lot of times. It's not a black and white or a cut and dry situation. And I definitely don't want to have any influence in their decision. I just want to be there to support the vet and to make sure that I'm a soft place to fall for whatever the client needs.
Gotcha. So what, apart from the actual cremation of the body, what other services do you provide?
So we also have urns. You can find those on our Facebook page. We have some traditional type urns. We also have wearable urns. You know, it's really up to your taste and what you'd like. I think the beauty of cremation is it does allow you time to grieve without having to make a permanent decision. It allows us a moment to pause and breathe and make and decide, do we want to scatter the ashes? Did my dog love Tobago? Do I take my dog to Tobago, you know, and really make a decision that feels right? So we also, for those clients that are concerned about whether or not it is their body and their ashes, we do offer video proof. I do know that this sounds very morbid. So it is not a graphic video. It's just an opportunity for us to make sure that they feel comfortable knowing that we have their best interests, that we are taking good care of their pet. And this is a service that we offer for anybody who wants their ashes back. It's not for everybody, but we just want to make sure that we are being super transparent and clear with our intentions. And I think that for us is the best way to do it. If somebody wanted to come and be a part of the cremation, we also offer that as a service. That's they would speak to their veterinarian about, though, and then speak with their veterinarian about how to develop that strategy. So they are welcome to come and do a small memorial. We are located in Dago, and they can do a small memorial, and they can be present when we say goodbye to their pet. But it really is something that I would discuss with their veterinarian to make sure that we have all of the right information and all the parts in place.
That is awesome. I actually, thinking about that, I would have loved to do that for my pets. It offers another layer of comfort for that grief that you feel, because in as much as it is a convenient way of saying goodbye to your pet, it's also a bit impersonal in the sense that how I have done it before is that, I would take the animal to the vet and then I'm asked, would you like to cremate? I would say yes. The people will come and collect the body and then I'm called, the vet calls me a week later or whatever to say, come and collect the ashes. So it's very impersonal and there's not any interaction with the people who are actually taking custody of your pet. So it's very helpful to know that you offer that service so that people can really say a proper farewell in the way that, you would imagine, because people, I don't think a lot, in fact, on the last occasion when I cremated my cat and I posted a picture of the ceramic jar that I put his remains in, and someone commented, "Cremation boy, you really love that guy." And I was like, yes, we're part of the family. I mean, how often do you have that kind of reaction from people, that the surprise that people would actually cremate their pets?
We do sort of get that reaction sometimes. I think the biggest reaction is from people that want to cremate exotic pets, right? Oh. It's just not traditional, but birds and rabbits. But love is love, right? And when an animal make an impact on our life, your grief is not compartmentalized. We don't grieve that way. Our grief is all encompassing. So I think it doesn't matter what the animal, what the breed, what the age. And so we do get those remarks occasionally, but we get that anyways, because we're in a veterinary community. When, it's like what I was telling you about my husband and how he grew up. Never imagined that this service that people, really needed.
Yeah.
And so, even for him, as he's watched this process and seen me go through this process with all the government agencies and all of that, I don't think he would imagine another way to save our pets now.
Right. Correct.
Well, and especially too, if you look at sort of the population of the cities growing and high-rise buildings and we don't have the traditional living situations anymore where we live in home, a lot of renting. You're not in the same position to bury and know that animal is going to be next to your house in the yard that they loved for the next 50 years. We don't know what the next 4 years hold. We don't know if we're going to buy a house, and maybe you're going to want to bury your ashes at that house. We get all kinds of different reactions, but because of the sort of shift in love for animals and their pets, I think it's the same as the funny reactions we get to people when they see our dogs in clothes. And they see me with my dog in my handbag at Starbucks. I think they get those reactions all day, every day.
Yeah, I hear you. I wanted to get a sense and to give our audience a sense of the process. So can you describe the process from collection to ashes so that people will have an idea of what you do and what their animal's body is going through?
Sure. So what we would do is, when we accept the body, we make sure that it is tagged with the client's name, the pet's name, and all the information regarding the pet to ensure that there can't be any lines crossed, right? We want to make sure that we know exactly whose loved ones we're saying goodbye to. Before we say goodbye to the pet, we remove all tags, leads. So we do suggest that people remove those things when they are making that challenging decision with the vet, or we ask that the vet does that. An eco-friendly crematorium, we do not burn any non-organic materials. We don't burn any bags. So if there is a blanket or something like that, we understand the emotional attachment, but it is our mission to be both animal friendly and eco-friendly. So we would remove all of that. And then from there, we say goodbye to the animal. We place it into the crematorium. depending on the size of the animal, it usually takes on average, I'd say about an hour and a half to complete the process. If it is a private burn, if it's somebody that wants their ashes back, then the animal would be alone in the crematorium. So we do make sure that there is no chance that there is ashes crossing or that you would get any other animal back. Once the burn is complete, then we pull out all what's left, which would essentially just be bone fragments, and we pull all of that out. We allow that to cool. Then that's blended and it is put into a small biodegradable box and labeled with your pet's name. We would then call your veterinarian or call the client, depending on the relationship, and allow them to come and get their loved one.
Gotcha. Is there anything that you request of, apart from the non-biodegradable diseases, and is there anything that the vet needs to do before he or she hands over the body to you?
No, we have communicated with the vet the importance of making sure that there's no non-organic materials, because as I said, we do want to protect our community and the neighborhood that we live in and make sure that there's none of that toxins, plastics, those sorts of things going in. We also request that no catheters, no medical material, no casts. Anything that is left with the body, we do double check, sure, but we do ask that beforehand. Or if the animal does have any plates or any sort of metal material within its body, if the vet or the client just lets us know so that we can be well prepared for that.
Right. Yes. Gotcha. And once the ashes are returned to the owner, is there anything that, like, for instance, if I wanted to create something with the ashes that I have, could I do that with you as well?
As far as like a memorial or?
Yeah.
So we have been in contact with some companies that do like nameplates. So if you did decide that you wanted to bury your cat, then connect you with other advocates who can create a nameplate that you could put in your yard as well. We don't actually do that, but we definitely know members of the community that can assist with that.
Okay, great. Sounds great. Well, is there anything else that you would like to share about Trinidad Pet Crematorium, contact details or anything else about the staff that work there? Before we wrap up,
we are a small business, but we are in connection with all of the vets in Trinidad. They're all aware of us. But if anybody has any additional questions, they can surely reach out to me on Facebook. I'm really transparent, happy to answer any questions. All of our permits and everything are public, so people can, you know, look into that as they want, if they want more information on it being eco-friendly and low emissions. But we are happy to answer any questions. My phone number is actually on the Facebook page under Trinidad Pet Crematorium, and I answer all of the messages. So if anyone has any questions, if they are in the process of planning an afterlife strategy to support, I also on that page, you know, encourage people to act as a support group for each other, to post pictures of their pets that they miss. You're surrounded by a community of people who understand how important pets are in our lives and how hard it can be when they leave our lives. So, you know, I encourage people to build that community and to really lean on each other.
Yep, that is very important. Kristen, thank you so much for agreeing to speak with us on Animalia. I'm sure that our audience will be very delighted to hear the services that Trinidad Pet Crematorium has to offer. And we wish you all the best. And we hope that people will consider cremation as a final option for your pets.
Yeah, thank you so much. I really appreciate the exposure. And you know, just like every other aspect of animal welfare, information and education are really, really key. So as much as, you know, you continue doing what you're doing and exposing people to some of the, you know, innovative ways that we're treating animals now and all of that, I think is really, really crucial and important. So thank you for doing this.
My commentary this week is about cats, but before you groan, hear me out. I want to talk about a specific kind of cat, and for good reason. I heard a story last week about acts of cruelty perpetrated against cats in a certain community. Not because they were being a nuisance, but because of their color. The old wives' tales and the negative sentiments many people have about cats is multiplied tenfold when they are black. One person decided he would beat and torture the black cats in the area because he believed them to be evil. The irony. But this is a common practice, and not just in TNT. Because of the color of their fur, their association with witchcraft, the plague, superstitions, and many other misnomers throughout history, black cats are unfortunately reviled. But I'm here to share some positive facts about black cats that you probably didn't know. The fear of black cats has a name, mavrogatphobia. Mavrogatphobia. There are many historical origins of this specific phobia, which according to the Anxiety Disorders Association of America, afflicts about 9% of Americans. The earliest hypothesis of a human's fear of black cats states that our prehistoric ancestors greatly feared the saber-toothed tiger, a vicious, primitive feline, and as such, humans avoided them to survive. There are two holidays dedicated to black cats: National Black Cat Day, which was first adopted in the UK on the 27th of October, and National Black Cat Appreciation Day, which is the 27th of August in the US. Black cats get their fur color from melanin granules, which are widely dispersed across their fur, giving them their rich black coat. The black fur color has evolved for generations for one main reason. It enhances hunting capabilities, especially in the dark. Black fur can also attract warmth on a much higher level than lighter colors. Cats are beautiful, fascinating, and friendly creatures. It may take some unlearning to break any association with bad luck and omens of death, but black cats, like any other animal, wishes to be cared for by loving humans. And I'll end with this interesting fact. There is some evidence that black cats may actually outlive other domestic cat breeds. This is credit to the gene responsible for their fur color. The gene is linked to protection against certain diseases. Now, if that's not lucky, I don't know what is. This week's Rescue Me hopes to find a loving home for two adorable pups. Here's Kristen with more.
She's called Penny. She actually went into a clinic here in the West called Sunnyview when she had tremendous skin issues and mange. She has made such a transformation. When she first went into the clinic, we feared that she was dog aggressive. We weren't sure. And now she is thriving and loving and playful and just such a delight. So I would just love to see Penny get some attention. She's a medium-sized mixed breed black dog with a few little white patches on her. And she's really, really special. There's also a little boy called Woody. He is another Tom Pup rescue. And he's also very sweet, fantastic with kids. Great family dog. He's currently in foster, just like Penny, but they're both looking for forever homes.
Many thanks to Kristen and all the folks at Trinidad Pet Crematorium for all that you do. Check out their Facebook page for more information about the services they provide. Join us in 2 weeks for another interview with an amazing person doing their part to advance the cause of animal welfare. I'm Natasha, and until next time, take good care and remember, love off your pets. Bye-bye.